Hello everyone, I'm very happy to see you here, and I'm going to share my story of defeating Samsung KNOX with zero privilege. KNOX is a Samsung's defense-grade security platform built into Samsung mobile phones. In terms of kernel defense, KNOX implemented many mitigations protecting the system from local privilege escalation on Android. My exploit chain can be used by any local application to bypass KNOX 2.6 and escalate privilege on Samsung KNOX SELinux. So here we go. Firstly, I'd like to introduce myself very briefly. My name is Shen, and hopefully you can call me Ratmi as my nickname. And I'm a senior security researcher of KinLab, formerly known as KinTeam. I mainly focus on the Android kernel vulnerability hunting and exploitation since 2014. And I aim to make out universal routing exploits for Android all the time. So when I found some exploitable vulnerabilities in April 2016, I applied these new exploits on many devices, including the Google Nexus, Huawei, HTC, and Galaxy S6, and many others. But actually, it's not working on the Samsung Galaxy S7 Edge at that time. So I want to know why. And I believe that there are some new exclusive kernel mitigations from Samsung KNOX. That is why I started to look at KNOX. So till now, I have already got some trophies on the Android routing, so you can see some CVE numbers there. All the CVE numbers on the list are the vulnerability which is exploitable. And actually, there is another new discovered influential kernel vulnerability will be announced in not too distant future. So please follow me on Twitter if you have interested in my future disclosure. So here is the agenda. Before we begin the presentation, I assume that you have the basic of local privilege escalation on modern operating system, and I also assume that you have the basic of SELinux. But if you don't, no worries, and I'm going to do a quick explanation later on. So the first part is an overview of KNOX 2.6, including the implementation of KASLR, real-time kernel protection, data flow integrity, and finally we'll talk about the SELinux enhancements. And finally, I will also explain how to bypass all these mitigations step by step. My target device is S7 Edge, and the model name is SMG19350, which is a Hong Kong version and Qualcomm-based SoC with KNOX 2.6. And I finished the exploit chain in June 2016 and demonstrated in the July 1st, 2016 on a conference in Shanghai, and the conference name is MOSEC. But this is my first time to disclose the details of the full exploit chain. So let's talk about the common local privilege escalation flow on Android. So normally, escalating local privilege on a standard Android devices requires four steps. Number one, you should achieve the arbitrary kernel memory overwriting by exploiting kernel memory corruptions like user free, double free, out of bound write, or anything else can help. Second, you should hijack the kernel function table and achieve the arbitrary kernel memory execution permanently. So for me, I always choose the PTMX FOPS, which is a function table for the PTY devices. So third, you by running the GOP gadgets or ROP gadgets in the kernel, you should override the value of address limit in the thread info. In the kernel, address limit represents the highest kernel address you can access from user land. If this value is a negative one, it means you can read and write anywhere. So at last, you also need to override the UID and SID in the proxy's credential to gain the root privilege. And You also need to override a global variable to disable SELinux. And SELinux is a security module for Linux kernel. It's almost hard-coded hooks every syscall and provides a mechanism for supporting the access control security policies. You can treat it as a kernel internal sandbox. But for the S7, there are S7 requires additional steps. First of all, you need a kernel information leaking vulnerability to bypass the KASLR. And after manipulating the address limit of your current thread, you still need to bypass the DFI and customize the SELinux enforced by Samsung KNOX. All above is the main topic I'm going to discuss today. So let's talk about the KASLR for Linux 3.18. Actually, KASLR is the kernel address space layout randomization, and it's not new for Linux, but it's still new for ARM64 devices like Android. Samsung implemented its own KASLR on ARM64 Linux kernel 1 year earlier than the upstream. So when KASLR enabled, a Linux kernel will be loaded randomly at any virtual address by bootloader. And bypassing the KASLR requires additional vulnerability to leak the kernel information. And in Samsung's repository, by enabling a configuration called config relocatable kernel, the kernel will be compiled as a PIE executable, and the bootloader will pass two parameters to the start entry of Linux kernel. One parameter is the physical address of Linux kernel, and the other one is the actual load address of Linux kernel. And kernel may save these two addresses to a global variable, which is boot kernel offset, and it will calculate the randomized offset of kernel. So before the kernel's initialization, there is a function called relocate kernel handles the kernel relocating. It's very similar to an AX64 linker in user space, and there is a RELA section. And in the kernel's executable file. And this section contains the entries of relative addresses, including the syscall table, the KL symbols table, and all other relocatable data. So for me, how to bypass it? Actually, I found a very easy way to bypass it. And for Samsung devices, you may find some logs file in the procfs. One of them is a TMA secure RKP log. And I found some kernel pointers leaked in this file, so I just simply dumped this file, and you will find that at the offset of 13B80, there is a kernel pointer leaked, which is init user ns. It's a global variable, and it represents the init process's user namespace. So with this leaked information, we can calculate the loading offset of Linux kernel in runtime and bypass the KASLR. So in this part, I'm going to introduce another vulnerability I use to achieve arbitrary kernel memory overwriting. I found several use after free due to race condition in perf subsystem, and reported all of them to Google at the end of last year. But please note that the upstream patch for perf event paranoid was not applied on Android at that time, so that this bug could be triggered by any local application at that time. And also, you can use any other exploitable kernel memory corruptions instead of this one if you want. The root cause of this vulnerability is that moving group in syscall perf event open is not logged by the mutex correctly. So by spraying the kernel memory, you can refill the structure perf event context and control the code flow by triggering PMU disable, which is a function pointer in PMU in perf event context. But to make this exploit 100% reliable is another long story. The full description of this exploit will be disclosed in the future, I think it's not today's main story. So let's focus on the real-time kernel protection, the RKP. RKP is implemented in both Linux kernel and the secure world. And the secure world can be trusted zone or hypervisor. It depends on the device model. For my S7, I think the secure world is the trusted zone. According to the SamsungKNOX.com, RKP provides the following security features. Number one, completely prevents running an authorized privilege code. Number two, prevents the kernel data from being directly accessed by the user processes. Number three, monitors some critical kernel data structures to verify that they are not exploited by the attacks. To summarize, it means you cannot run your own code in the kernel or manipulate the data in the kernel before you bypass the RKP. So here is the RKP call. RKP call is a security call entry of RKP. And many critical kernel functions call this function to enter the secure world, including the slab allocation and deallocation routines, page table operations, and copy or overwrite or commit credential routines. So RKP provides several protections. The first of them is kernel code protection. Actually, this is not an exclusive feature for KNOX 2.6. Most 64-bit Android devices had enabled a configuration called kernel text read-only while compiling, so that the text section or the code section is not writable and the data section is not executable as well. And also based on the ARM's feature, which is privileged execute never, the PXN, user code is never executable in the kernel. And I also noticed that there is a new feature called the control code protection, control flow protection. In the new release, the kernel, in the new release, KNOX 2.8, it's also known as control flow integrity, the CFI. I think this may be similar to the control flow guard on Microsoft Windows, but I haven't analyzed it technically. So another protection is kernel page and page table protection. RKP provides read-only kernel pages for sensitive kernel data and objects. Only secure world can allocate and deallocate or and manipulate these kernel pages. So these pages table entry should also be protected from the page attribute manipulation as well. When kernel needs to access protected PGD, PMD, PUD, or PTE, the related routine will call RKP call to enter the secure world. And this picture on the slides is a code of function set PTE from Samsung's repository. If RKP is not enabled, the code has only one line. It just overrides the PTE by itself. But if RKP enabled, it will firstly query if this PTE is for the protected pages. If it is, it will call RKP call, and the secure world will do other things, for example, to write the PTE for kernel. Another protection is the data protection. Data protection is based on the page protection. Some critical global variables are stored in the section .rkp.prod.page. And pages in this section cannot be overwritten anymore after kernel initialization. So far, protected variables include initcred, initsec, and secure ops. Initcred and initsec represents the credentials and the security context of init process. They must be protected from writing, otherwise it can be used for DFI bypassing. We will explain DFI later on. And another one is secure ops. A secure ops is a SELinux hooking function table. If it's writable, attacker can bypass SELinux by overwriting its function pointer. So here is the last one. The last one is kernel object protection. The kernel objects in heap also can be protected by RKP. The Linux is using the slop heap management, and every type of object may have a kernel memcache as a object leader. So far, three types of objects and their kernel memcache are protected. The first one is a cred jar RO, represents the process's credential. The second one is tsec jar, represents process's security context. And the last one is VFS mount cache, represents the process's mount namespace. They are all read-only in the kernel space, only writable in the secure world. All right. Actually, there is a history about bypassing the KNOX on S6. Actually, the kernel object protection has been applied on Samsung devices for a very long time, and it can be bypassed on Galaxy S6 very simply because of the lack of DFI and additional checking in the secure world. On S6, you can simply call the kernel function RKP override CRES to ask secure world update current process credential for you. So even this trick is not working on S7, the function RKP override CRES is still useful in my S7 exploit chain in another way, so I will show you later. The RKP override CRES is a kernel function. So it is possible to call it from the user land if you can hijack the kernel function table. And in the original Linux kernel, the kernel can call the override CRES to update a process's a credential. But in Samsung's repository, this function is replaced by the RKP override CRES. It will allocate credential and security context in read-only kernel memcache, and then call the RKP call to ask secure world finish the credential updating. Here's another function, which is RKP assign CRES. Actually, it's the real implementation of override CRES in the secure world. Samsung finally realized that some exploits were taking advantage of this function to escalate privilege on S6. So they started to verify the credentials passed from the normal world, and the secure world will crash instantly if the credential is illegal. There are two phases of the tracking. The first is the same with the DFI checking in Linux kernel. The other one will check the UID of credential. So let's talk about the UID checking first. So before the ADBD and Zgold startup, the UID checking function will always return a log, because if these two processes are not startup, it means that Android system are not initialized yet. So everything is allowed. After that, if unprivileged process try to call this function, there will be a checking, which is UID checking. Actually, after that, unprivileged process cannot override the credential with high privilege. That is why the old tricks on S6 was not working anymore. However, in fact, on S7, you can still use this trick to modify the kernel's compatibilities of your current credential. Even changing UID is not permitted. You can change your credential with full kernel compatibilities. So another checking is integrity checking. Actually, it's do the similar checking with a kernel function called security integrity current in this kernel. So I will analyze that function later. Before that, let's talk about another old trick to change the credential. For now we know that the credentials are read-only on Samsung devices, but so that you cannot manipulate it directly, but can you use another way? I mean, what if I point the current credentials pointer to init cred, just as that picture on the slides? But after tried, the answer is I failed because of DFI. So let's talk about the DFI. DFI is data flow integrity. It's new in KNOX 2.6 and implemented in both Linux kernel and secure world. its main entry is Linux kernel in security integrity current. Well, its main entry in secure world is that integrity checking. So DFI also adds some members in the specific structures in the structure credential. It adds four members. Among them, there is a BP task. It's a pointer to this credential's owner. And there is also a BP PGD. It's a pointer to the process's page global directory. And also in another structure, which is a task security structure. In this structure, DFI adds one pointer, which is BP CRED. It's a pointer to this security context owner. With all these additional members, DFI can get the ability of tracing the data flow of credentials and security context. So here is a security integrity current. It's a hard-coded hooking in every SELinux routines. So almost every Linux syscall will at least call this checking function once to check the data's integrity. That is why it's a real-time tracking, and this function will check the following things. The first one is it will check if current credential and current security context are allocated in the read-only pages. So otherwise, maybe if they don't check this, attacker can reallocate a malformed credential in the writable pages. So the second one is it will check if the BP task in credential is the current processes. And the third one is it will also check the BP CRED in the task security structure is the current credential. Finally, it will also check if the current mount namespace is the read-only one and if it's malformed. All right. So to summarize, with RKP and DFI, even if we achieved arbitrary kernel memory overwriting, we still cannot manipulate credentials and security context in kernel mode, and we cannot point the current credential to the init credential to escalate privilege. And at last, we also cannot call the RKP override request to ask secure world to help us override the credentials with UID from 0 to 1000. It means you cannot use this function to gain root privilege. You also cannot use this function to gain a system privilege. But we still can do some things. We can call the kernel function from user mode by hijacking the check flags in PTMX ops. But please know that the number of the parameter is limited. For me, I only can control the low 32 bits of X0 register. But that's enough for me, so I will show you later. Second, we can override the credentials with the full kernel capabilities, as I have said. Before. And finally, we still can override some other unprotected data in the kernel if it's useful. So for me, how to bypass RKP and DFI? My main idea is ask kernel to create a privileged process for me. This approach is really simple and easy. Normally, I think you may think about it and you may try to call a function which is call user mode helper. But unfortunately, it has four parameters. As I have said, I can only control one from the PTMX FOPS. So I choose another way. I call another function which is orderly pour off. Orderly pour off will create a worker thread to create a new user mode process. The executable path of this process should be fixed, and it should be always the sbin pour off. And the path of this executable file is in the global variable. Its name is pour off cmd, which can be manipulated. I mean, it's writable. So you can just overwrite this variable to your own executable path and call this function to execute your own root privilege process. So here is the full steps. First, I will call the RKP override class to override current credential to gain full kernel capabilities so that you have the ability to call the user mode helper. Otherwise, it will be denied. Second, I need to override the global variable power of CMD with my own executable path. For example, my path is data data SS7 killer. So the third, I will call the orderly power off. Then my file SS7 killer will be executed in the kernel thread context with root privilege. And the security domain of this process is kernel. And after that, I will modify the SS7 killer's address limit in thread info so that the new created process also can read the unread and write kernel memory. So finally, I will, the SS7 killer will call the RKP override class again to change its security domain from the kernel to init because init has a higher privilege than the kernel. So here are the results. I got a root privilege process and I also got a init domain in the security context. However, this process is still restricted by the SELinux. You will never gain a real root access until you can bypass the SELinux. It's not good enough. For example, with SELinux enabled, a init process cannot connect socket with some untrusted applications. You even cannot remove some files created by some other processes. So actually, it's useless. So bypassing SELinux is very necessary. So here, let's talk about the SELinux enhancements made by the Samsung KNOX. On other standard Android devices, SELinux can be simply disabled by overwriting the SELinux enforcing to zero in the Linux kernel. So when it's a zero, it means that it's not enforcing, it's permissive. So everybody can do everything on the Android. But for Samsung, it's not working long time ago. Samsung removed this global variable in the kernel long time ago by disabling a configuration called config security SELinux develop. And also, init process cannot reload SELinux policy after system initialized, which means after Android initialization, attacker cannot simply change its domain to init and reload a customized policy to bypass the SELinux. Furthermore, the permissive domain is not allowed neither. The permissive domain was officially used by the Google before the Lollipop for policy developing purpose. On KitKat, you can see that init process has a permissive domain, which means even SELinux is enforcing, init process still can do everything it wants without a permission deny from the kernel. After that, Google removed the permissive domain on Lollipop's SELinux policy. But permissive domain is still allowed by the kernel's SELinux access vector checking routine. If you can reload a customized SELinux policy with permissive domain declared, it's still a good way to bypass the SELinux. So here is the kernel support of permissive domain. You can see that a permissive domain's access vector database will be marked as AVD flags permissive. As you can see in the AVC denied function, if the flags is AVD flags permissive is set, all denied operation can be allowed. Unfortunately, S7 removed it very simply. So for Samsung's repository, this function just simply returns the E access without any exception. So permissive domain is not working. Even you set your process to permissive domain, it means nothing. So how to bypass SELinux on S7? I come up with some approach, and finally I choose the most easy way, which is cheating the kernel that SELinux is not initialized yet. If SELinux is not initialized, all the operations must be allowed. And so this status depends on a global variable, which is SS initialized, and it's writable and not be protected. So if you can override the kernel memory, it's very simple, so that you can just set this variable to zero. It means that it's not initialized yet. So have a look at this chart flow. So firstly, all SELinux hooking routines will call the AVC has perm to query if current operation is allowed by the AVC access database. But before the query, there is another function called security compute AV. We'll check the global variable SS initialized. If it's zero, it will just return a law without a real check. So SELinux can be bypassed in this way. And if SS initialize is set to zero, all security labels will reset to none, except the kernel domain, because the kernel domain is using a fixed SID in SELinux. The kernel's domain will always be one. But for other processes, other domains, SID is generated dynamically. So when you reset the SELinux to uninitialized, there is nothing there, and you can see that there is no security domain there. So if you set the SS initialized to zero, loading a customized policy and reinitializing the SELinux can be possible. So for now, I can load a customized policy. Let's talk about the policy customization. So the original policy database located at SFS SELinux policy. So firstly, we need to load SELinux policy in the user space and modify it with the libseepol API. After that, you can insert allowing rules into the database, and you can allow domains like untrusted application, unit process, and the toolbox domain to do everything. So finally, you still need to recover the SS initialized as soon as possible, because if SELinux is initialized, other processes with non-security label can create a non-label files and craft the file system. So it looks like nothing happened on your mobile phone if SELinux is initialized. But in fact, when you reboot your mobile phone, and you will see that it cannot start up. So that's all about the exploit chain and bypassing techniques. Finally, we got a full root access on Samsung Galaxy S7 Edge with KNOX 2.6. And you can see that there are some processes called DemonSU. Actually, they are the root service process of SuperSU. And it means that the device has been rooted, and you can simply type SU to gain the root privilege in the ADB shell or do anything you want. So to summarize, I firstly leaked the kernel information and bypassed the KASLR. Then I use the CVE 2016-6787 to achieve arbitrary kernel memory overwriting. After that, I asked the kernel to create a privileged process for me to bypass the RKP and DFI. Finally, I cheat the SELinux is not initialized. Then I reload my own SELinux policy to bypass the SELinux. So, and at last, I gain a full root access and fully bypass the Samsung KNOX. As you can see, bypassing the KNOX is really difficult, and I believe that it will become much harder to bypass it again in the future. That is because the Samsung KNOX team really understand exploitation. They know both attack and defense part of Linux kernel. They make out so many mitigations, and they are still trying to improve that. So definitely, it will become much harder to bypass it. After that, I'm going to show you a demo. One second, let me switch the screen mode. Okay. So here is a video. I drag into the first. I show this video in the ADB shell because it's easy to capture the screen. Actually, this exploitation can be used in any local application. You can just insert this exploit in a malformed application and upload it to the Google Play or anywhere else and let somebody else to download it and execute it. After that, their devices will be rooted. So for now, we just simply use the ADB shell to show you. So till now, I create the first one. You will see that there is a data local temp SS7 killer, which is my created process made by the call user mode helper. It's created by the kernel thread, and after that, this process creates some other process like daemon SU, so that the root service of super SU was started. And you can see that I can simply type SU to gain the root privilege on S7H. All right. So okay. That's all of my talk. If you have any questions, you can ask me in the wrap room. I will be right there. Thank you for your coming. I really appreciate that. Thank you very much.